is the Schaefer Baseball Report, an inside look at America's pastime. From Little League all the way to the big leagues. Now here's your host, former Major League infielder Jeff Schaefer.
So, Ray.
What's up?
Good to see you. Andrew.
What's up?
Hola, amigo.
Hola, ¿cómo está?
Oh, yeah, we're going. Ray, you understand that stuff. Do you speak Spanish?
Yeah.
You do?
Yeah.
Like fluently?
Yeah.
Does Ray?
No, he's a gringo.
He's a gringo.
He has no clue.
He has no clue, huh?
He has no clue.
So, do you and your wife converse in Spanish?
No,
at all?
No.
No.
So, my grandparents spoke no English, and they wanted me to speak to them in English, and they spoke to me 100% in Spanish. So that's how we communicated. They speak to me in Spanish, speak to them in English. My parents was first generation, so they spoke all English. They know 100% Spanish too. So I never really grew up speaking, like, you know what I mean, having a conversation, just only listening. And
in Spanish?
In Spanish, yeah.
But you never spoke it really in Spanish?
No, not really. No.
So you understand it more.
But I understand it.
Yeah. But you could. But
I could. I mean, I could hold the conversation, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
But it's different because it's a matter of whom I'm holding the conversation with, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
If I'm holding it with, you know, somebody that really knows.
And it goes too fast.
And it goes too fast. They'll start looking at me like, what are you talking about? But if I'm with you, I'll just look. And they know I don't know what the fuck I'm talking about. Are we live?
Yeah, we're live.
Yeah. Oh, no, we're not.
Not Mevo live, but we're on the podcast.
Oh, you're going to have to bleep that one, Andrew.
I don't know. I kind of like it.
No.
No.
Because you didn't say it in Spanish.
Well, I apologize. But no, yeah. So I mean, it's funny when I'm with somebody that thinks I know 100% Spanish, and I just start talking to somebody, look at me like, what are you saying? I was like, don't worry about it.
Yeah, I think I understand enough to be dangerous. You know, I mean,
yeah.
I took 3 years of Spanish in 1 year in junior high, and then two in high school.
Gotcha.
So, but I didn't do very well in junior high school because Senorita Roberto was smoking. So I didn't pay attention to the words. I'm like, wow, every day I walk. Like, that's the one class I never missed, but like I got a D, I think.
it's tough. I mean, it used to hurt my pockets when I had to pay for Ray and my daughter's tutoring for Spanish. And it's like, I can't believe I'm paying someone to teach my kids Spanish. And like, you know, because it's totally different, you know what I mean, from the school system to, you know.
It's like an old Cheech and Chong line where he goes, I go to night school, I take Spanish, and I get a B.
Cheech and Chong, I don't know if Andrew knows what Cheech and Chong is.
I know.
I don't know. So, yeah, he does. But, hey, we got an awesome guest today.
I can't wait. I'm excited.
I know. We've been talking about this for a while since he hit, Twitter and Facebook and all that.
Oh.
But that's Jeff Frye, and he's a former major league player. 8 seasons in the big leagues, couple seasons in injury laid, and actually missed 2 seasons through injury, but got to the big leagues pretty darn quick, man. Drafted out of like Eastern Oklahoma State Southeast Oklahoma State. You know, every time you start to add like more direction to a school, you know it gets smaller.
Yeah, exactly. East, West, North.
You start, like, you got Maryland, then you got Maryland Eastern Shore, then you got Southeast Maryland Eastern Shore, then you get Southeast Northeast Maryland Eastern Shore. You know, next thing you know, there's like 8 people on campus. You don't even have enough for a team. But that's where he went to school. But he did. He's a 30th round draft pick by the Rangers, and within 4 years was in the big leagues.
Wow.
Not a big guy. Probably the same stature as me. Probably played around 5'9", 5'10".
Okay.
You know, he probably a little bit heavier, 180 in there. He played, I think I played at 170, 175, my max.
No kidding.
Yeah. So, but I don't even know if guys like that would even get drafted today. That small. And primarily a second baseman. So was I.
Yeah.
So, you know, you don't get drafted as a second baseman anymore.
No. You know, you get drafted as a hitter, and then they move you around.
Center field or catcher.
Yeah.
You know, those guys, and then they go. But mostly they're recruiting guys up the middle, but. And then they moved to wherever. But Jeff was primarily a second baseman, and you know he played everywhere, every position in the big leagues, except pitch and catch.
Was his dad the coach in the major leagues? Because you know all the dads put their kid to second base. Think about that.
Why would a dad put a kid at second base?
I don't know. It's just like, you know.
We see all these travel ball coaches that think every kid's a freaking shortstop.
Well, I mean, I think the older, once they get older, they start putting them at shortstop. But like in the younger levels, like.
Yeah. No failure on that side.
Yeah,
I guess if you're a good baseball guy, that's not a bad move. But
you know.
I guess I'm not. I never did that.
Threw him in the fire.
Yeah, right into the heat. You know, yeah. It's funny because Zach was a first baseman. And, you know, Zach is, he's tickling 6 foot right now.
Yeah.
You know, it depends on how he combs his hair, you know, how high up his hair goes.
Yeah.
And love playing first baseman. He's a good first baseman. You know, he really is. He's a good defensive first baseman, but he never, you know, he's not going to go to college as a first baseman. But he never wanted to come on. I'm like, Zach, you got to play second. You got to play the middle. We got to play some third. Wanted no part of it forever.
Just wanted first.
Just wanted to play first, you know. And then you put him in another position on the field, and he was bitter, man. I mean,
really?
He'd get pissed. He hated it.
Wow.
Hated it. But, he's got that.
It's a lot of action over there.
He's got that in him. Like, he likes to slap tags on people. He, you know, he likes to talk crap. And,
yeah.
You know.
Whoa,
yeah.
Who'd he get that from?
My wife. Have you not met Amanda? Oh, good God. But we want to bring on Jeff Frye. And yeah. So let's go a little bit into what he's doing now, right? So now he is the certified hitting guru on Twitter and Facebook. And it is hilarious. It's almost like Domingo Ayala type stuff.
Oh, it is pretty funny. I mean, you just said all his baseball stats, and I think everybody knows Jeff Frye now because of all the stuff he's doing on Twitter.
Exactly. I mean, realistically, he was a good player. He was a solid player. I think, what'd you say,
279,
something like that. I mean, those are good numbers.
Yeah.
Over eight seasons. You know, in eight seasons, pretty interesting, though. Eight seasons, I think he struck out only like 279 times or something like that.
That's impressive.
That's
especially for this day and age.
That's impressive, right? So, so what he talks about, it's kind of funny. So we'll get him on. We'll find out why, how he got to this point and take it from there like we always do.
It's entertaining, I'd say, right. For the most part.
Well, this is, we're going to bring on Jeff. How's it going? You driving?
No, I'm not going to leave till 9:30, so I got some time.
Good, good. And you're living down in Texas now?
Yeah, I live in Fort Worth.
Okay, so you're originally from Oklahoma.
No, originally from California.
I saw that you were born in Oakland, and then but you went to school in Oklahoma.
Yeah, I went to halfway through my junior year, I moved with my grandparents, my aunt and uncle, and four cousins, all girls, to Panama, Oklahoma, a town of 2,000 people.
No kidding. How about that? So, we're sitting here with.
It was not easy at first. we're gonna be
bleeping. Oh, good God, Ray dropped the F-bomb earlier, man. We're gonna be bleeping the heck out of this show today.
I know I like this guy for a reason.
Ray Torres here, and Ray is one of the coaches in our organization up here in Charlotte, North Carolina. I'm originally from New York, but we're down. Ray's from New York, and Andrew, where are you from, Andrew?
I'm from Charlotte.
You're from Charlotte originally, right? Family's out of Chicago or something like that, somewhere over there. But, so we're following you. We went through your whole bio and everything before we brought you on. And, a 30th round draft pick, second baseman, pretty much everything, very similar to me. I went to Maryland. I was a 12th round pick, but I was primarily a second baseman. Doesn't happen that way anymore. How much baseball on the amateur side are you following?
Well, I follow quite a bit. I mean, I've been an agent for 18 years. Mm. So I don't really pay much attention to the perfect game publications and all that crap. But
good for you, man.
I go watch games sometimes, and this summer I actually helped coach a 17 and under team with some friends of mine, some former teammates of mine. It's pretty fun.
Yeah, it's good that we do that. We've been doing that, 15 years now, Andrew?
Mm-hmm.
About 15 years in the youth side. It's interesting, especially when we stepped out of the out of pro ball, and then you don't realize what the landscape is and how much has changed since we were growing up. But what kind of little league did you have in that small town of Oklahoma? That did you have like two teams, three teams? What was the deal?
Yeah, no. Back then, I mean, I was a teenager then. I mean, I did play little league and stuff in California, mm-hmm. and just normal little league and stuff. And then, but when I was in Panama, we had a town team that played in this league called like the OK Kids League.
Teenagers drinking beer after the game.
We play games on the weekends against other towns. Yeah. And then the following 2 years, I played for Spiro American Legion. And we would do the same thing, go to different towns and play doubleheaders on, probably three times a week or something like that. Yeah. And just get after it.
Yeah, man. So how do you get recruited out of an area that way?
You don't.
Did you walk on there, or did you walk on at the Southeastern?
Well, I went to Carl Albert Junior College. It's a JUCO that was 10 miles away, and I actually got recruited by Eastern Oklahoma Junior College, which is in Wilburton, to play basketball at a high school. And that summer, playing for Spyro American Legion, I got 15 hits in a row over 3 days. And the local coach came out and asked me if I wanted to come to Carl Albert and play baseball and basketball. So I went to Carl Albert for 2 years.
And did you play both when you were there for 2 years?
Yeah, I started playing basketball. I made it up to, like, our first scrimmage and was, like, started looking around going, man, I'm going to come in the game and shoot free throws in the last minute. And
so you started to realize that you were a short white guy. That's when it hit you, huh?
Yeah.
From Oklahoma.
And we didn't have 3-point line yet.
Yeah.
I mean, in high school, we got it. You know, as soon as I got to college, we had 3-point line. But I'm playing with dudes from New York and Chicago. Sure. And studs. And dudes are hitting like 28-foot jumpers. I'm like, I don't know.
You're throwing elbows.
Yeah. You got
some
water. I mean, that's what I was doing.
Dude, so a lot going on, obviously, on social media now, and if people are not following it, it's 03 Frye, Frye on Twitter. But so I went on this morning to check it out.
It's actually O. Sorry about.
It's O.
When I first did it, yeah.
O3. Okay, O3, not 03. O3. Okay. All right. So, are you blocked?
No.
Okay. Then I went on 03. That's what it was this morning. I went on 03 Frye, and I'm like, oh my God, he's already suspended. like he's pissing some people off, man.
Trying to avoid.
Oh no, that's outstanding. So you're doing the you are now the certified hitting guru on social media. So it's 03. Fries, you guys got to go on and check it out, because if you haven't seen it,
you're late if you haven't seen it.
Yeah, you're late to the party. It's classic. But so, you know, how does that happen? I mean, you're hanging around one day having a beer and just said, you know, I'm tired of watching this stuff, right? You know, I got to have some fun and turn the video camera on and go to work. And now it's, you know, I think something like your first post or something like that went to like 11,000 views or something like that. Is that right?
Yeah. It was the second had like over 80,000.
Wow.
I mean, it's crazy. It's, I have three buddies of mine that two of them are currently scouts. One's stopped scouting, but they all played minor leagues and, you know, been around the game their whole lives. And so we just kind of share some of these silly videos in our mind that, you know, on social media that these coaches are teaching these young kids with, and we just kind of send them to each other. And so one day I'm just walking around the backyard and messing around the garage, and I was like, I saw one of these old crappy tee I had. I said, I'm gonna do something stupid. And so I got my older son. I said, hey, I want you to video me. I'm trying to do what this kid is doing in this video. So I get this little red piece of plastic about a foot long, and I do this kind of move with it, like rotating my elbow underneath or something. And I said, oh man, the light bulb just went on. This is a joke. It's like 12 seconds, right? And so I put it on Twitter, and one of my buddies, one of the scouts, goes, dude, you got like 400 views already. I'm like, really? That's crazy. And then I look like a couple hours later, it's like, dude, you got 4,000 views. I'm like, what? I mean, couldn't believe it. And then I was like, you know, I thought, you know, I had no plans to do any of this stuff. And you know, I was just going to make one silly video, whatever. And then the backlash I got from...
You poked the bear.
All these,
you did. You poked the bear.
All these guys,
right,
teaching this stuff. And, yeah. I mean, direct messages and attacking me and asking questions about my son. Show your son. And, you know, finally I had just got so mad. I was like, I got to, you know... I'm sitting at home pissed off now because of that video. So I'm like... Well, you know, now I have to make another video. And then now it's just gone on and on. And now, like, I think I've made, like, 8 or 9 videos.
Listen, my favorite is the inversion You know, the sit up, the thing that turns down because he can't convince himself to launch angle.
Oh,
and his swing has always been directing down to the ball. So he turns himself upside down.
That was not easy to make. I couldn't figure out which way to turn the stupid thing. I'd be facing the right. And get my son, I was like, how do you think I need to turn this thing?
That's your production crew, how you and your son.
My sons, my girlfriend, and my cat dog.
Oh, my God.
And then I look, and the dog's laying on the mat, and the cat's wandering around. So I'm trying to keep them out of there.
No, they got to go. You got to get them in. And they got to start doing, like, credits at the end. Like, that was my cat, Bob.
You got to teach a dog how to put the ball on the tee.
There you go.
Well, one of the funny tools they use is a thing called the chuck it. You ever heard of that?
Mm-hmm. The dogs, the chuck it with the
throw the tennis ball? Yeah.
Every time I see somebody using that, I was like, seriously, dude, you can't throw a ball 50 feet?
Oh.
You know, you really need that tool to throw a stinking ball. What an athlete, right? That's what I'm thinking. And so I saw this, that some people are using this thing. So I've got one of those. It's going to be
dude. So what's you know, Ray? We you know, you watch his video and you look, and he's got the whole bucket.
He's got the whole setup.
Got the whole thing in there. So he's got some PVC in there. He's got the inversion table. He's you know, the other one where he puts the L screen right in front of him.
He's got it all. I mean, he's got it off on the $10, and you know, all these hitting gurus got $10,000 worth of equipment.
One of my best friends who used to throw batting practice to me when I was with the Rangers. He's 70 years old, and we go fishing. And so I talked to him this morning, and I was like, "Hey, man, do you have a fishing net at home?" And he's like, "Yeah." I was like, "Can you bring it over? I need to use this thing in my videos, because some of the videos I've poked fun at, they're using the actual fishing net to scoop a ball off a tee."
Oh my God, that is funny. That's funny.
Oh, so, man.
Anything you can use other than a bat, right?
No, I'm sure your garage is taking on a whole new meaning to you. Like, this screwdriver. Oh, yeah. Like, what can I do with this screwdriver?
I just walked through there looking around going, damn, I got that.
So now you bring into the ending of every video is great when he goes, Shegone.
I was saying it around my house last week, and my wife was like, "What the hell are you saying?" I was like, "Shegone." So she realized what I was saying.
She's like, she thinks that this coronavirus, like,
she thought I was going crazy.
I'm like, "You're out, babe." She gone. No, that's outstanding. So, you know, like, people are really, like, coming after you. You know, it's pretty interesting because you know, I guess there's one guy for sure that's just, you know.
Yeah, the guy in the jeans.
Yeah, he's screaming, you know, I'll challenge you with any video. And I'm like, oh, my goodness.
I don't understand why you don't take him up. He's paying for all your traveling expenses. Come on, Jeff. That's a free trip.
Yeah. What do I have? What could he possibly
do? Oh, no, he's a clown. This is Ray Torres, by the way, and a big fan of yours. I've been following you for, I mean, a whole 3 or 4 weeks now.
hey, Jeff, that's funny, right? So we go through our whole career hoping we have a big fan. You got one in Ray.
Hey, all right. Listen, I love your work. You know? What I think now is happening is that, you know, due to the coronavirus, there's a lot more people, you know, eyes on, you know, social media and stuff like that. And you and Mar Freeman, you guys are kind of exposing the fraud guys out there now, you know what I mean? And I mean, I hate to say that they're fraud, but you know what I mean? They haven't done what you and Jeff and, you know, Marv has done out there in the baseball world for them to even try to challenge what you guys are saying or say you guys don't know what you're saying. It's kind of insulting because these guys are just becoming...
stealing money, man.
Well, they're becoming famous on just putting stuff on social media, no content, no evidence that is working, that they've done it, and this is how they've done it. And it's just funny that you guys have made it into a comical show and exposing all the hitting all the certified hitting gurus out there. And you know, you guys are just bringing light to it. And it's pretty funny, I must say.
You know, Kevin Euclid was, he's pretty harsh too, man.
Yeah.
There's some good guys out there. So one of your posts I commented on, I said, you need to start a certified hitting guru academy online, and then when you graduate, you get a Shegone shirt.
Yeah, that's a good idea, man.
Oh, man, I'm telling you, You know, people would sign up for that. And, you know, the people are going to sign up to think that you're really teaching. You know?
Oh, my God.
Oh, I know. Some people think it's real. That's the funny part.
Have you seen him, man?
Yeah.
You got the fan.
I see him on Facebook.
So what's the fan? You got the, you just drug that out of the garage, the fan?
Yeah, one of the deals they talk about, if your swing like an oscillating fan or something. So, yeah. I mean, you see the mojo in the background for dove hunting?
Yeah,
I got it. I mean, my bucket keeps growing. I might have to get a bigger bucket. But the Shegone thing is, sorry to interrupt you, but the Shegone thing was really just, I got it off of Hawk Harrelson.
Sure.
And Hawk Harrelson was my favorite, one of my favorite announcers I've ever listened to, because he was funny. Yep. And, you know, he'd say, grab some bench, or sit down, bus driver, or, you know, he'd say, Shegone, stuff like that when he strikes out. So, yeah. And I just, the first video, or the second video when I did the Shegone thing, it just, I really didn't have plans to do it.
Oh,
and
it's
I just
phenomenal.
Did it, and everybody started loving it. And believe it or not, I'm meeting with a guy today to help design our, design a website. And the Shegone t-shirts are in the works.
Isn't it funny how it just expose something?
Yeah.
Really, for what it's, you know, it should be exposed, because, you know, we live in the youth travel showcase world. Ray Sun is one of the top catchers in the country right now. You might want to check him out if you're an agent.
He's next door. He goes to San Jack.
We go through this on a daily basis, man, because we run into these characters that are teaching hitting, or they're in a cage down the road, or they got a bucket of balls, and, you know, they have no clue what they're doing. And they're, you know, I actually walked out of the shipyard down in South Carolina one day, a dad and probably a 14-year-old, can I say 14? And his father was explaining to him that the balls that he hit, what angles he had them on coming off his bat. Like, walking out of the yard, I'm like, I got to stab myself in the eye right now.
He said off the hit tracks on the video game, on the hit tracks, your launch angle was 27.
Yeah,
and
my
today,
spin rate was...
Your spin rate, yeah. And today was only 14. What's going on? Like, you could do it in the cage. Why can't you do it in the game?
Yeah, it's amazing. You can do it off a front toss. You're really good at that, off a front toss. But, yeah, it's a thorn here in the youth side, especially for a lot of guys that have been through the game, you know, at higher levels and... You know, been around great hitters. You know, you've been around some of the great hitters. Was Baines, did you play with Baines, Harold?
No.
He was gone at that point?
Okay. I came up with the Rangers, and then I went to the Red Sox, the Rockies, and the Blue Jays. So I came up with the Rangers. They had Palmeiro, Julio Franco, Juan Gonzalez, Ruben Sierra, Fudge. And then Red Sox, I had Mo Vaughn, John Valentin, Nomar.
Yeah.
And then I go to the Rockies and play with Larry Walker and Todd Helton, Jeff Cirillo, and then Blue Jays. They had Delgado, Raul Mondesi, Jose Cruz Jr. I've been around a lot of great hitters. And the whole thing is, nobody says you can't do things different ways, right? We all know that you watch a baseball game and you're not going to see two guys hitting the same. Mm-hmm. So there's different ways to hit. And what's really, if these guys would have just shut up and gone away and not said anything, this probably would have never got to this level.
Yeah.
Okay, but they're attacking guys that were successful at the highest levels and saying, we don't know what we're talking about, and calling names. And it's just, I mean, it's just kind of everybody's rallied around him. Chipper Jones chimed in the other day. Chipper Jones, Brett Boone, Rusty Greer. Marvin Freeman. I mean, it's just the list. I mean, Euclid, Mike Cameron, Torrey Hunter. I mean, these are some dudes, you know. These dudes are not, you know, they didn't just have cups of coffee. These guys are successful hitters. And now, apparently, what we did and the way we learned was all wrong, and now you have to hit this new way. It's just the end.
So I have a quick question here. So with all the noise that you guys are making, you know, through social media, is it bringing any attention to, like, MLB, you know, with the hiring process of, like, the new guys that they're hiring, you know, that don't have any past experience, that just have, you know, these certifications, let's say, and, you know, are guys on upper levels of the major leagues coming to you like, you guys aren't to something, you know, like you guys are exposing them now. Is anything yes. like that happening?
Yes, it is, and but it's in the dark, so to speak.
Okay.
Yeah. Guys who are employed by major league teams that believe in this stuff, they can't really speak out publicly. So, but I get direct messages from front office executives, from scouts, from coaches. Everybody is on board because they see what's happened to the game.
Yeah,
they see the people that are running this game, and you know what it's turning into when baseball lifers' opinions aren't valued anymore. And I mean, it's a shame. I was at the winter meetings 2 years ago with a scout who's been a scout for. He's like a scouting director, assistant scouting director. He's been a scout for 30 years, and some goofy-looking dude walks by. He says, "See that guy?" He's like, "Yeah." He goes, "He's got more say than anybody in this room." Oh, like, geez. That's a shame.
Yeah.
That's not the way it's supposed to be.
No, it's unfortunate. Scouts were the early hit on all this. Then they started just to, you know, you're an agent. Now these guys are trying to evaluate people on video, you know, out of college. What's going to happen now without the college season and how are they going to evaluate that? So this is where the scouts have to come back into play.
Yeah. Because there's no analytics and there's no numbers now that you could, you know, validate or verify, you know, when you sit in a boardroom talking about, hey, this guy, his numbers are through the roof. There are no numbers. Now you got to see who's the real baseball guys, who has the tools.
Yeah, and plus scouts, I talk to scouts on a daily basis. Players are getting drafted now that have not been seen based on their numbers.
Based on social media hype.
Spin rate.
Yeah.
Based on their walk to strikeout ratio, things like that. And now when you go to – it started probably, I don't know, 5 to 10 years ago where I started noticing video cameras at the games. So these guys hold their phone up and they have not video cameras, but their phone. They use that to record. They hold their phone up behind the net, and they have the radar gun right in front, and they video in the pitcher and showing his velocity because he's not a real scout because he doesn't know what he's looking at. So he has to record this to send this to somebody so they can look at it and try and determine if this guy is a prospect or not.
Amazing. Amazing.
So there's no more guys walking up and just looking at a pitcher, seeing swings and misses, but like, this guy's a pitcher. They just say, oh, he throws 96, but he walked 8 guys, and they're like, this is the guy we want.
Yeah, the real scouts do it. The real scouts know what they're looking at.
Yeah.
They'll sit down the line and watch a guy and see how hitters react to him and see his delivery and all that. They know what they're looking at, but a lot of these younger guys just walking around with their backpacks on and you know, all their tools in their backpack and video and stuff, they don't know what they're doing.
Yeah. Well, Jeff, continue success with this, man. We love it, and I'm sure you're going to get some more abuse along the way, which it sounds like you built to handle it, and you actually kind of enjoy it. But you got to be spending a lot of time just checking your Twitters and stuff now. I mean, just out of curiosity. More time on social media than you ever thought you would be on.
More than I want. I feel like somewhat obligated to keep this going, and because I think, you know, we can do some good from this. And, you know, if somebody takes the time to send me a message, I kind of feel obligated to at least respond to them. And I mean, my Twitter's gone from 600 followers to almost 4,500 in a month, and Facebook and all that crap is, you know, I'm just constantly, seems like I'm constantly answering questions and stuff. So I don't know if I get too many. I don't know if I'm going to be able to answer them all, but I'm going to do the best I can.
All right, man. Well, we appreciate you and keep it going. And hopefully we'll stay in touch. And in maybe 6 months when it's up to, you know, 150,000, we'll do this again.
Yeah, absolutely. So, keep going.
Okay.
And I want a T-shirt, man. I want a Shegone.
Me too.
Yeah. Well, I appreciate you guys having me on, man.
Man, thank you, Jeff. Appreciate you taking the time. All right, have a great day.
You guys too. Thank you.
That was some good stuff.
That was funny.
So it's amazing, right? I mean, what you know, what's out there? I've said all along. You can put three guys in a cage 100 yards away, right? Mm-hmm. Three separate cages. Okay, one guy never played. One guy might have played, you know, a little bit here and there, and another guy is an experienced baseball player, hitter, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
And you take somebody and you just have them front toss, right? And you just have them make actions and just move.
Yeah.
You're going to pay the same for that guy that has no experience as the guy down in cage three that's done it at the highest levels, that understand what the mechanics of a swing is supposed to be and,
yeah,
you know, and the mental approach to hitting and all that other stuff. But yet this guy's got a bucket of balls and he can, hey, I played in high school. State champs in high school, man.
State champs.
Well, the guy that, the difference between the three guys is that the guy number one that has no experience has got all the twos and the gimmicks and everything else, and people like to see the bells and whistles, and the guy in the third cage, he's got all the professional knowledge and all in his head that he's going to teach you. You're gonna grow a lot more.
You're going to develop him.
You're going to develop him.
Yeah.
But people are like, oh, he's boring. He's not really, you know what I mean? They don't, you know.
People, you'll go buy a car, you'll shop for a car.
Yeah.
Right? You're going to buy a house, you're going to go look at several different houses. Yeah. Right? So this is basically an investment.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So if you're going to go out and find somebody that understands, you got to do your research. Just like we talk about with organizations.
Well, 100%.
You know, if you don't go check everything out and understand what it is, because a lot of times, especially organizations, is these parents and these people think that the name on the uniform is going to get them something special.
No. They feel like, hey, the name on the uniform and I'm spending all this money is definitely going to get my son a college scholarship. Damn. It does not work like that. A lot of the organizations, they got their top teams and they do it.
Sure.
They do it right for those teams. And
the national teams.
Yeah, absolutely. Once you're on that national team, you know.
Good for you is right.
Good for you. And they treat those guys like big leaguers. And they do it right. But for the other 18 teams that's behind that national team, they all think they are going to get the same treatment that the national team. Those guys on the national team sacrificed, and they did what they had to do to get on that team. You know, they didn't pay the money just to be on a team. I mean, they pay something, but what my point is that they just didn't pay just to be there. They earned it through their skills.
See, that's why we talk about us. I mean, it's been, and people that listen to the podcast have heard me say this numerous, numerous times. That's why USA Baseball process is the legit process out there.
Yes.
Okay, because when people hold these tryouts for these organizations, there's two tiers to it. Is this a national level player, or does his check clear? Because if his check clears, then I can put him anywhere I want, on any team I want.
Yep.
You know, but if he's a national level player, I'm going to go get him, and then that.
The national level player doesn't go to the tryout.
No, more times than not.
No, he gets recruited.
He's recruited. He's called on it. But again, even these guys who are on national level teams through the summers, sometimes when they go to these big events, they find another national level kid.
Oh, yeah. And to go back to your point, which you just said, what makes USA Baseball so special compared to, you know, a lot of the other major organizations around the country is that USA Baseball, no matter if you're a national level player or you a, you know, just a guy that just started out that want to be on a USA team, everybody's got to go through the same process. They have to go through the same thing, and everyone's got to be, you know, you're not just because you're, you know, your name is ringing bells, you're just ahead of the curve. I mean, you're going to get there a little faster, but everybody's got to start at the same level. You got to go through the NTIS, or you got to go through USA Championships.
Futures or something.
You got to go through something. No one just gets an automatic shot straight to
USA your check. Team. Your check only gets you an opportunity to try out.
Yep.
Your check doesn't get you a uniform. You know, you have to go through the, you know, and again, more people than not will not put their kids in that environment because they're afraid to see the failure.
Oh, the failure. Yes.
Oh my God. Because you take some of these dudes from all these national teams, there's only one national team.
Yeah.
You know? So you're going to take these guys from all over the country that are dudes. They're big fish in their little ponds everywhere they go. And you're going to put them on the same field with all these other national level guys. And only one guy's coming out.
That's only one guy.
So, you know, it's all of a sudden, oh, man. You know, then he walks around like a failure. What kind of failure are you? You tried. You went. You took it to the end.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you don't give yourself an opportunity to go ahead and challenge or put yourself in a situation where you can fail.
Yep.
Then you're not doing yourself any good. And that's what happens with team jumpers and everybody else is they're going to go where, you know, it feels good.
Yeah.
You know, it feels good because I don't want my son hurt. I don't want my son yelled at. I don't want my son, you know, I just want him to, you know, walk around like he's the man.
Yeah, I don't know that feeling. I always put Ray on another level above him. You know what I mean? He had to just find his way and just get there, you know?
You got to fight, man.
That's it.
You got to fight because once you get, and I see it at the college level now because, you know, we spend so much time with Queens. You know, I've been close to college baseball in terms of the recruiting side and helping players get there. I've never been around the game as much as watching the practices and, you know, interacting with the kids and watching the body language of all the stuff. Because when you go to a college game, I just see the kids that are on the field.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know why the kid in the dugout's not playing.
Yeah, the 25 guys, yeah.
I don't know why he's not playing or not. Yeah. But these kids step into these environments, and all of a sudden, they're challenged.
That's right.
And all of a sudden, what do you mean I'm not starting? What do you mean I'm not starting as a freshman? What do you mean I'm not starting as a sophomore? What do you mean you're recruiting on top of me?
Yeah.
You know, guess what, dude? You're not that good.
You're as good as your last at bat.
So, you know, and it goes back to the processes of finding the right school for the kid where he's going to play.
Yes.
You know, everybody gets this, you know, they want to wear that D1 on their chest. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm a D1 player. You know, how many times have we seen D1 kids go, not play, transfer out, and end up, you know.
Oh, it happens every year. I mean, it's a revolving door. I mean, that transfer portal, I wish they made it public so we could all see. You really see the true numbers of guys in and out. I mean,
it's... Listen, you got a 30 to 35 man roster. Mm-hmm. Okay, you're gonna put 9 guys on the field in the DH. So you're gonna have 10 men in your lineup, one way or another, right? You're gonna have your hitters, and then you have your pitcher. You'll have 10 guys. That puts another 20, 25 on the bench.
On the bench, you know? Yeah. And then you got to do it every single day for 4 or 5 months. I mean, it's not even 4 or 5 months. It's from the time you walk in August to, you know, the last game in May.
You could be shagging for 3 years.
Yeah.
You could literally be shagging. You could be in the last group hitting. You could be, you know, you're going to take, you know, thousands of ground balls before you even get on the field of fly balls.
That's right.
So if you love it, you stick around and you do it. You know, and there's more to just being in uniform, being on the field. Obviously, being on a team and being around the guys that you... You know, the type of personalities you're used to being around your whole life.
But goes back to the point of, you know, the kids at an early age that they just, you know, jumping into these programs just to say that they go into this program instead of they haven't been tested. They haven't been pushed. You know, I mean, 4 years of high school, they don't know what it is to see, you know, I mean, somebody better than them in front of them. So now when you walk into that program as your first year, and now reality hits. What do you do? You know what I mean? They don't fight. They take flight.
It's when I got drafted, and you know, I went to the tryouts, the workouts. I was one of a few guys invited to the Orioles tryouts, and you know, I'm thinking, holy cow, man, I got this. I'm standing on the field taking ground balls with Rich Dower. You know, who's the starting second baseman on the World Championship Baltimore Orioles. You know, and I'm like, dude, I pick as good as this dude.
Yeah.
You know, my arm's as good as this guy's. I got this. I'm going to, you know, if I start thinking, hey, Dower, you know, leave your jersey. I'll wear your number. Leave your jersey in the locker. I'm coming. But then you get into the environment and you go to your first spring training and there's 200 people there. And that's when they brought, like, everybody. We used to change in shifts, you know, at the Orioles because the locker room wasn't big enough.
Yeah.
There was a big Latino influence starting to come over at that point. And then you start to go, okay, you know, all right, I'm an all-ACC player. I'm an honorable mention All-American at Maryland. Like, I'm the guy. I'm one of the guys in the country.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, you're just a guy.
You're just a number.
You know, right. Now how are you going to climb through that pack, right? Yeah. So if you don't have that competitive edge, if you don't have that in you, or you haven't been, you know, we grew up in a different environment, a different time, right? You know, we competed without parents around. We competed, you know, playing, you know, in the street. We competed, you know, down in the yard playing football.
You had to compete to stay outside. I mean, if you wasn't good in basketball, you just didn't get on the basketball court. If you wasn't good in, you know, street football, you just didn't play. If you didn't, I mean, that was just something that you just had to be just a competitor, just to be out there with the guys.
Listen, when you got in the game, you know, you bring it up, you know, there was a basketball court down the road from my house growing up. You know, like 2 blocks down. And in my mind, 2 blocks down when I was this big was like 2 miles away.
Yeah.
It was like, you know, I could throw a rock to the second block. And, you know, they were the older kids playing. And I was probably 12, maybe somewhere in there playing basketball. So I'd go down there, you know, and you'd shoot when they were going inside. And you'd wait and you'd wait and you'd wait. And you'd wait for weeks.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden somebody doesn't show up and it's like, you want to play? Yeah. You know, I've been here the whole time. I want to play. Now you get in the game and nobody passes you the ball.
That's right.
You know what I mean?
You just start taking it.
But then, that's right.
Yeah.
Then you start to go figure out, okay, how am I going to engage?
Yeah.
And, you know, once you break in, you better perform.
That's right.
You know, and then next time you go down the street, it's like, we'll take Schaefer.
That's right.
We'll take this guy. We'll do whatever. And I don't necessarily see that edge anymore because everything is structured. Right.
Yes.
From, you know, church basketball to rec basketball to organized soccer, to, you know, to Little League, to, you know, travel, showcase. And their parents take them everywhere, and they massage them through this whole process where we would step out to play a game, and you were the GM because you had to pick the team, right? Okay, I'm taking Ray, you take Andrew, whatever. You know, remember you get the bat and you go, your fingers, and get first pick. And then, you know, you'd pick your team, and then you were the manager. Who's batting first? Who's playing where?
Oh, there was a lot of people mad
at
you.
Oh, yeah, right? Yeah. And then you start to, then, you know, okay. And then you get into the game. And now you're competing with nobody around.
Yeah.
Just you guys, you know? And that's day one. And you're going to play all summer long on the street like that.
That's right.
And you're coming back after it. And you got a different team every day and a different players on there.
And it's, like you said, there was nothing structured about that. It just made you a better player, better athlete, just a competitive mindset. Now,
and that's what it goes back to. That's your key. That's the key word is competitive mindset. So now these kids go into these environments.
Everything,
you know,
is
they're all showcase guys. You know, they
manicure fields, beautiful fields.
Hey, dude, we got one of those. Don't knock that.
Oh, hey, listen,
and don't drop an F bomb behind it either. No, but that's, you know, they have everything.
Yeah.
Right, they have every opportunity, but what they don't have, what they're missing on the majority, is that I'll rip your throat out mentality. I'm going to take what you have today, and that's it, you know?
Yeah, it's you know, I mean, they have, they're like, the day and age of the kids right now are so much more advanced and skilled than we ever were,
right?
At 14, 15, 16, going through the ranks. I mean, these kids are so much more, you know, but... I don't know. It's just like a double-edged sword. You know what I mean? You got the highly talented, skills, you know, fully developed kids at 15, 16. Or do you want them to have the mindset, because that's going to take you through the rest of your life? I mean, we all get old. I mean, I used to have a six-pack. Now I got, you know.
Now you got flat
six-pack under ice.
Flat abdominals.
You know, so, I mean, yeah. I mean, so all the physical part of the game and everything else goes away at some point. Yeah. But your mindset and your competitive nature, you know what I mean? Like, it's going to take you through the rest of your life.
I had a conversation with one of my longtime friends that I grew up with, Alex Fournay, and Alex was a great competitor, overachiever, right? Football player. And his mindset was always like, I'm good enough to get to the NFL. I'm good enough to get to the NFL. And we had this conversation in the office the other day, and I haven't spoken to him at this length in a long time. And he said, he came to realize, he started to compare himself to other people as far as athletic abilities and opportunities. And obviously I was, in his circle. So I was one of the guys that he compared to. And he started understanding, like, okay, I don't have the physical tools anymore, but the mentality that he had, thinking that he was going to the NFL and he was going to work to the NFL and he was going to do what he needed to do. He quarterbacked at Bucknell. And then it didn't happen. But all that led up to not happening took him beyond the point of,
what,
you know, and now right. he's one of the, well, it was Computer Associates for a while, I think that the soul, but he was one of the top executives for them for years. You know, I mean, he can stop working tomorrow if he wants, but now he's going back and he's looking at trying to be a coach, but an executive coach, and taking these people and saying, okay, this is, you know, these are the mindsets that you have to have. Because I can imagine now how many people that are in the business world that were not athletes or where the athletes, like we were talking about, where it was kind of handed to them and like, oh, you know, it's going to be okay.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden it's not. And you got to feed your family. You know, you got mortgages to pay and all that other stuff. You better have that. You better have that edge.
Oh, I mean, you know, we shall see in the future what's going to happen. But now it's going to be the guys that just going to go out there and grind to put the food on the table for your family, because it's not going to be, you know, as easy as it was 2 months ago, you know, as everything was so accessible, and it's going to change. I mean, this coronavirus is going to change the way we live. Now we got to adapt and figure it out. But again, it goes to being adaptable, you know?
Yep. And competitive.
Yep.
So what do you got, Andrew?
You guys took everything. I didn't have to say anything the whole podcast. It's like, geez.
Do you want to say something?
No. Not now.
Not now?
No.
We took everything.
Like, we gobbled them. Like everything I was going to say, you guys said something.
Two New Yorkers eat the week.
No, I'm not weak. Look at my calves.
Yeah, that's right. Look at that tool. that one tool. It's amazing. Well, Ray, appreciate you, man. That was a fun podcast.
Yeah, that was a good one.
So, and Andrew, always, you're the man setting all this up and
I know.
Taking care of us. We show up at when the switch says
on. I didn't even know it was on.
When it goes on air. Yeah, you threw the headset on.
Yeah.
You say you're here at 10.
You know, we need to put a green light to let us know that it's on.
We'll have that in the new studio.
Yeah, we're going to have a new studio. Oh. That's another, you know, that's a whole, we'll do that on the Mevo here. But the rumor mill is just, it's pathetic.
Oh.
I mean, everybody's got a story about everything.
It's, really?
It's crazy. But, you know, it's what we live in. You know, it's fun. Everybody knows better than everybody else, but nobody goes to the source.
Well, that goes back to where, you know, we started out with Jeff and, you know, all the guys that he's going against, you know. I mean, this guy played in the big leagues. That's where we all would love to be where you
guys. This guy played in the big leagues and shouldn't have played in the big leagues. When you're a 30th round pick and you're 980 pounds, you know, and you get to the big leagues in 4 years.
He dropped names. He dropped names of probably like 10 Hall of Famers. Just sure, now, you know what I mean? Yeah. It's like unbelievable.
Forgot mine, but
sorry. But you know, a guy that's teaching hidden lessons in jeans. You know what I mean? Could definitely. Sure. Hey, no knocking the guys that's doing it in jeans, but
hey, if you got the knowledge, wear whatever you want to wear.
Yeah,
but,
exactly.
You know, if you don't. But all right, everybody. Well, we appreciate it. I don't even know what podcast number that was.
87. I was about to say 47.
He's got dyslexia.
Yeah.
So, yep.
All right, man. Well, thank you, everybody, and we will do this again next week. Peace out. Yeah.